of doing ministry, relating to one another, relating to our community, new ways that will require us to live closer to Him and greater dependence on Him and less dependence on the pattern we've gotten used to.
Amen.
What we've been doing on Sunday mornings, our youth are presenting issues to us. This morning, Katie presented about recycling. Some of us say, oh, yeah. But then I had her to relate it to what scripture? She said, and I said, first book, Genesis, where He gave us dominion over everything, for us to be good stewards. And so you see, even in our recycling, and some of you say, I'm reaching, no, I'm not. Because God gave us this earth and expects us to take care of it. Therefore, instead of putting a plastic bottle in the trash can that's going to go in a landfill and stay there for 30 to 50 years, we can recycle and have another bottle. See, God is still speaking in God's wisdom, but see, we need to be there supporting these children. And I thank those of you who have been there, but see, we're doing things in a new and fresh way. Because I could have gotten up here and said that, and we wouldn't have heard it. But see, Katie got it, and she presented it because God is speaking in new and different ways. And that's what we've got to be open to, Glen Haven. God is speaking to you in new and different ways. Someone said, well, I'm tired of doing the same old, same old. Do something. About it. If you're tired of the way it's going, you see, I'm always trying to do something new and fresh. And it's not about me, it's because God is speaking in new and fresh ways. God is bringing forth new preachers, new pastors, because He's doing something new in ministry. You know, I never thought I'd fit the mold, and God said, I called you because you didn't fit the mold. See, we think we should be called because, you know, I gotta sit here and look. Then when they get up and then they fuss at you because you ain't jumping around and waving your hand. But you ain't do nothing either. You ain't crazy. You just sitting there looking all erudite and sophisticated. And then they get up, somebody ought to be praising God. If you ain't never done nothing for you, stay on your seats. You better show some sign that God is good. You see, God is breaking molds, y'all, because He's sick of that. He's tired of that. He's ready. Lastly, a fourth point. God's people need God-led leaders, not self-led leaders. You know, some of us trying to lead out of how we're feeling at the moment. I don't think that's the way God acts. No, in fact, I know that's not how God acts. Because God is always doing things for His people because God's people, as Brother Fred loves to say, people matter to God.
Yes.
So God is calling for God-led leaders, and He's doing it because when somebody gets upset and they lash out at us, we can still move forward.
That's right.
When somebody doesn't do what they're supposed to do, we're going to keep moving forward. We're not going to say, well, they ain't doing nothing, so neither am I. I'm tired. Not T-I-R-E-D, T-I-E-D. I'm tired. Look like your hands and your feet are tired. Amen? But you see, God-led leaders are going to go on because when God has called us to do something, we can't stop. You shouldn't be able to stop. If you can stop, you're not sold out. If you can stop doing what you were called to do, you are not sold out. So I don't need to come up in my face talking about I'm sold out. Don't step to me saying you're sold out, you love the Lord, and you hear the praise and the worship, because if you can stop a call, you are not called. Because God knows if I could have stopped a call, I would have stopped this call. Amen. But when God called, He says, but you're going to bless others, and then in turn, I'm going to bless you by blessing others. So yeah, I'm going to call on you to not be able to hang out with your buddies, go hit some tennis ball. I'm going to call on you to be working on the word because I need for you to speak a word for me. Yeah, we're going to have to come out of some of the things we're doing, but God needs God-led leaders. Who are going to say no to the crowd? Who's going to say no to doing the things that you want to do the way you want to do them all the time? Those are God-led leaders.
Right.
See, the closing section of this chapter brings us to Joshua's encounter with the commander of the Lord's army. And it's considered to be one of the several pre-incarnation appearances of Jesus in the Old Testament. Look at verses 13 to 15. Once when Joshua was by Jericho, he looked up and saw a man standing before him with a drawn sword in his hand. Joshua went to him and said to him, "Are you one of us or one of our adversaries?" He replied, "Neither, but as commander of the army of the Lord, I have come now." And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and worshiped and said to him, "What do you command your servant, my lord?" The commander of the army of the Lord said to Joshua, "Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place where you stand is holy." And Joshua did so. You notice how God is always in a preparation mode?
Yes.
I just started noticing that more and more. Yeah, God sends us to do, but before he tells us to do, God is preparing us. God is preparing us. You know, that's why I'm so big on us praying before our meetings, our rehearsals, our worship, because God needs us to be prepared in our hearts before we move forth trying to bless God. See, Joshua was all alone outside the camp, looking up at the city walls, thinking about the best way to take the city. But then this armorial talks about, take off your sandals. First he had Joshua remain the man. Now Joshua's had to take off his shoes. Oh, God is always up to something. But you see, it's never a question of whether God is on our side, as Joshua was asking this appearance, but whether we are on God's side. Joshua went silently and just fell on his face in worship, in submission before the Lord. How many of us have submitted to God today? Joshua called himself a servant and asked for his battle orders. Did you ask for your orders or did you write your own? You see, this was the same thing that happened to Moses. He had to take off his shoes because he was in the place of holiness. And see, when you're in the place of holiness, you say, "God, what would you have me to do? What would you have me to do?" The promises that God made to Joshua in chapter 1, they're coming true at this point. What Joshua's experience on the plain of Jericho can be true for us as well. No matter what we're facing, no matter how complicated or difficult the problem in our lives, it provides more opportunity for God to show his power. Here's King Jesus, the captain, the commander-in-chief. He's the one who gives the orders. Ask us to listen and take him seriously. Then he gives us his strength to live one day at a time. And not until we take the place of a servant, can he take the place of Lord in our lives. Joshua understood this need for the Lord's direction in his life. And he knew that he was second in command. Even as a leader, even as a parent, we are second in command.
Yes.
Sometimes we think we have all the answers, but we need to be second in command. Joshua had tremendous capability, but he knew his limitations. And it's crucial that we be led by God. Whatever the leadership task that we're called to, some of the greatest military leaders in history became pathetic failures because of unchecked pride. Thinking they had all the answers, not humbling themselves, not falling on their faces before the living God, claiming his strength, not claiming his strength and not listening to him. But just as it's true for Christian leadership, pride can quickly and easily drive us. But when God is at work in us, people are going to know the difference. Whatever the spiritual leadership we're called to exercise, at home, in the church, in the community, we need to have a clear sense of being led ourselves. The ultimate leader is the commander of the army of the Lord, before whom we are privileged to daily fall on our faces, acknowledging his holiness, his supreme leadership, his promise to provide the energy and the resources we need for the tasks that are ours. Martin speaks of James and John coming to Jesus, saying that they wanted to be number one and number two in the kingdom. See, they were driven by ambition and competition. They were not God-led. Are you willing to follow and do what God wants you to do, even though you're not in complete understanding of it? Are you willing for God to prepare you? You see, what you're going through, God is still preparing you. And oftentimes we keep going through because God is continually having to prepare us. We just don't seem to get the lesson. But when we get the lesson, we're going to come forth like Joshua and the people of Israel, where we